Hi, my name's Jorg. And welcome to the Money Program.
This is YouTube, a website where over 70 million videos are watched every single day. It's changing the way we watch television and creating a new generation of program makers who've decided they'd rather do it themselves. YouTube has got both the old broadcasters and the advertising industry running scared.
I'm totally gonna make a video tomorrow. You better be here to watch it.
And it seems everybody's at it. Even me.
Hello. Now, I'd like to know why all you creative people out there, yes, you, would prefer to make your own videos than rely on the stuff that the big broadcasters, like the BBC, make. So please, tell me what you think.
Tonight, in the second part of our series, Coming to Your Screen, the Money Programme investigates the rise of DIY TV.
My name is Kate. I'm an art student.
These two people are divided by over 60 years in age and live in different parts of the country. And yet, 18-year-old Kate and 79-year-old Peter have something very surprising in common. Like thousands of other people, Kate and Peter are broadcasting themselves to a global audience. And in the new broadcasting revolution, programmes aren't being made in expensive TV studios, but bedrooms and studies across the world. Anyone stumbling across YouTube might just think it's the preserve of young people or people who are very good with computers. But the person I'm about to meet now is one of the most famous YouTubers of them all, and he'll explode that myth into a thousand tiny different little pieces.
Hello, YouTubers. As you can see, my head's still above the parapet.
This is Geriatric 1927.
I've done the washing up, so here we are.
He's incredibly private. I can only tell you that he lives somewhere in Britain.
I was 12, just going into my second year at my new school when the war in 1939 started.
After his YouTube debut, Peter became a worldwide phenomenon.
He has become the latest internet sensation. A 79-year-old widower has been posting videos of his life story on a website normally frequented by teenagers and students.
He's called Peter, he doesn't give his surname, and his first film on the YouTube website has been viewed by almost 500,000 people in just over a week.
Peter has so far resisted the massive media attention that he's created. No interviews, no photographs. He's never been filmed by anybody but himself. That is, until now. Hello, Peter.
Hello.
I'm Max.
Hello, Max.
Hello.
Come in.
Thank you very much.
I found YouTube, I suppose, by accident. I do slideshows of family photographs and things, and I wanted to find a way of making them a bit more interesting. I expect I Googled something and found YouTube.
Peter was fascinated by the films he saw on YouTube and decided to join in and have a go.
Hello, YouTubers. I thought I might tell you another story today. So if you're sitting comfortably and you've got a nice cup of tea, I'll begin.
He quickly became one of the most viewed stars on the site. So what exactly are Peter's films about?
Originally, I thought, since I'm an old man, I thought I have lots of things that we tend to grumble about constantly. So I thought I would just do some grumbles and gripes about things that annoyed me.
But the experience soon became rather more rewarding.
Well, I do in a way find it cathartic. Yes, I do, because it's made me look back on my life and I've remembered all sorts of things that I thought I had forgotten, and it's very nice.
Like Geriatric 1927, Kate is 17 is another YouTube star. In real life, she's Kate, a student from East Anglia, but behind her bedroom curtains, she acts out all sorts of different characters for her quirky and funny short films.
Why did you start doing YouTube?
I posted a video response to someone I admired. Even though we may be on opposite sides of the world, I think we could still have fun.
Her first video showed Kate's talent for larking around.
And people liked it a lot. And I was making people laugh, so I thought I'd make some more.
How long ago was that then? How long have you been doing it?
3-4 months now, I think. Yeah.
So what kind of films have you made? If somebody's never seen your stuff on YouTube, how would you describe it?
I try to make people laugh. That's the main thing. Hit current topics, like spoofs of games and music, that kind of thing.
This is one of Kate's films mimicking the video game Tomb Raider, with Kate playing all of the parts.
Okay, momentary blip. Just need to get the hang of this.
A lot of people like that because a lot of people who are on the internet and on YouTube play games. It's their realm. And they really appreciated the comedy that I took from that.
Her YouTube site is hugely successful.
How many people watch it?
A lot of people. I don't know for sure. I can check if you like.
Yeah. Let's do a live update. You've got 1.7 million viewers. Do you not find it strange? And do you not find it slightly awkward when you appear in front of your little camera in your bedroom, and there's 1.7 million people out there watching?
I try not to think about it. I try to make something that I find amusing and then pass it on. To think there's that many people sitting on their computers looking at me is very daunting, to be honest.
What Kate and Peter are posting onto the internet is known as user-generated content.
What people mean by user-generated content is the ability for somebody in their home or dorm room to take video and upload that onto the internet. One talented individual in the countryside can all of a sudden become an important force in the larger media landscape.
Sites like YouTube make it possible for anybody anywhere to put anything online for everybody to see.
Every morning when I wake up, I get up and I check my messages. Then I check my subscriptions to see if anyone has posted any new stuff.
So even if you're a talking thumb from Chicago, your views can still be spread across the world.
You can find just about anything on YouTube. There's millions of videos on there, which some are good, some are bad, but you could find what you're looking for.
I'm addicted to YouTube.
And if you can't, you could put it up.
Yes, I am.
You ready, man?
And even a daredevil jump can bring you a moment of fame.
Skip it!
I've been using YouTube to find out why some of its fans seem to prefer it to television.
Hello. It's a while since I posted that first blog. Okay, so let's see what some of you are saying. I don't watch mainstream TV much. Okay, fair enough. And there's a video there as well. Hang on, let's have a look at this.
Well, to answer the money program's question about YouTube being, you know, better than television, in a way, I believe that it is, because you can watch whatever you want, whenever you want.
And this is a part of YouTube's incredible success. The site was founded just 2 years ago in California by computer programmers Chad Hurley and Steve Chen.
Hi, YouTube. This is Chad and Steve. We're the co-founders of the site, and we just want to say thank you. Today, we have some exciting news for you. We've been acquired by Google.
Last October, internet giant Google bought it for $1.65 billion, earning Steve and Chad $671 million worth of shares.
Thanks to everyone of you guys that have been contributing to YouTube, the community.
Yeah, I'd be laughing too. YouTube, with its crazy mix of homemade videos and pirated clips taken from traditional telly, proved irresistible to Google. But why did it pay such a massive amount of money for it?
Google has paid over $1.5 billion for YouTube, but actually there isn't really a revenue model there at the moment. But what they've bought with YouTube is an immense community, a big club of eyeballs, of viewers, consumers. And that's an incredibly powerful proposition to be able to offer an advertiser, for example.
Especially as advertisers are worried that the YouTube generation is turning away from television.
YouTube has changed my television habits completely. If I want to watch something, I will usually find it on YouTube before I turn on the television to find it.
I do know that people who used to switch on the television when they first got up now switch on the computer. And at the moment, so many of them switch it on to see what's on YouTube.
YouTube's success has led to hundreds of other internet channels trying to get in on the action. This is called Rather Good TV, but I'll let you be the judge of that.
You're watching Rather Good TV. I'm about to show you some basketball skills. How'd you do that?
It has its office and studios on a converted farm. Handy if you need some agricultural props for filming. I hope they're organic. Zeb Ashley is the star of Rather Good TV. And Dean is the technical guru.
Today, our main headlines. Bong! Half plate, half wizard eats Harry Potter.
Bong! A badger dressed as a man has been labelled a badgervestite by the police.
Together, the lads write, shoot, produce and edit all the material for the channel.
He's coming up next. He's going to be on right now. It's just going to have welcome to Rather Good News.
It's an acquired taste, but Zeb is under no illusion as to what the channel does and who its target audience is.
It's on now. Watch it.
It's the same as, I don't know, eBay or something. You just chuck it all out there. Someone will like it, someone will want it. So you just, that's what we're doing, providing as much as we can. And then if people like it, they like it. It doesn't really matter if they don't.
Rather Good TV is television, but on a shoestring, and typical of the new channels that are making their way online.
I'm done. Goodbye for now.
But it's not all non-stop funny videos on the internet. Others see it as a business opportunity with real money-making potential. I've come to Cardiff to visit an unlikely TV channel. They've got a few lights, a camera, and a green curtain. And with this, the possibilities, it seems, are endless.
Hello, my name is Jerry Wilson, and welcome to World News from Franchise News 24. In today's headlines...
Franchising is a £10 billion industry in the UK alone. Richard Williams launched his channel in 2006 to tap into this lucrative business.
Franchise News 24 has been set up to provide our viewers with news and reviews from anything that's happening in the world of franchising.
Richard left a career in healthcare to buy a franchise. He discovered that the websites advertising them were deadly dull and decided to create his own. Then he realised he could also create a TV channel to go on his website, going from novice to broadcasting magnet in one leap.
The money comes from our advertisers and sponsors. As long as they can see the content that goes out there is quality, it's dynamic, and it will attract potential franchisees for their business or affiliated services, they're more than happy to provide content for us.
Franchise News 24. AquaShield is the largest domestic roof coating company in the UK, installing a waterproof...
But the channel doesn't just carry glossy corporate adverts for franchises. There's more to it than that.
We have a UK news presenter that presents the things that happen and when they happen in the UK.
Hello, my name is Jo Standing and welcome to Franchise News 24.
And we have world news reports that's presented by, as you can see there, our Jerry Wilson, our world news presenter.
In today's headlines, Barbecutie, a national and international barbecue franchise company, has announced the signing of two new franchise partners in North Carolina and Ohio.
And Richard invites businessmen into the studio to talk about their franchises.
Now, you might think a TV channel dedicated to the world of franchising may not have any chance when put up against programmes by the BBC and ITV and Sky. But in DIY TV, forget big budgets and forget big audiences, because niche is the new mainstream.
And we knew it would be successful and well-received. We didn't realise how massively hit the channel would actually be. But because this is niche television, we don't need more than, you know, I don't know, 100, 500 concurrent viewers at any one time. People log on, they log off.
And that's the whole point of niche broadcasting. A few hundred people watching may not sound many, but they're all people tuning in because they're specifically interested in the content of the programme. And that's good news for the advertisers.
In 2002, David Abedin decided to turn the innovative systems that led to his personal success into a business, creating an international business consultancy, the Quantum Organisation.
Even the boss gets the chance to be a star. I wanted to ask one of the channel's guests why he thought appearing on it was good for business.
David, hello, I'm Max.
Oh, Max.
Hello, how are you? So what are you doing on Franchise News 24, then? What's the point?
Do you know, this is a really exciting medium. It's new, it's different, and let's face it, the internet, particularly now that most people have got broadband, is a great way for us to get our message across. And I think that what Franchise News 24 are doing really is trailblazing a media that is going to become very popular indeed.
Hello, my name's Jo Standing, and welcome to Franchise...
Richard may be starting small, but he has big, big plans for his channel.
We see ourselves in 5 years' time running 20 channels for different companies, and we're set up to do that. It is a money-making machine, and this will be the first of many, many niche TV programmes that will be moved out there into the World Wide Web.
So are you in profit now?
No. It's, you know, it's going to take quite a few months for us to be in a situation where we're going to be in profit, but it's all about the medium to long term, not the short term in this business.
Rather Good TV and Franchise News 24 are part of a collection of hundreds of channels shown on View TV, an online TV station. And if you want to join them, this man can get you on air in double quick time.
We can produce a TV channel from moment of first meeting and discussions to live on air within 6 to 8 weeks.
Jamie is gambling that the future of TV rests with the internet. The setup costs are significantly cheaper for a start.
If you wanted to create your own digital satellite TV channel, the minimum cost you'll be looking at is way over a £100,000 setup, and between £80,000 and £120,000 a month, every month. With View TV, to start up a channel, you're looking at about £10,000 setup and then £5,000 a month.
And with View TV, you can broadcast programmes about any subject you fancy. They've got entire channels devoted to movie trailers and to local community programmes. Oh, and don't forget Zeb.
It's me, Zeb, and I'm currently in San Francisco.
Jamie has bigger plans.
We have 900 channels available that can be watched through your laptop, your PC, and now even a set-top box, which is to be released very shortly.
The set-top box plugs into a broadband connection and then straight into the TV, so there's an advantage for advertisers. The technology means they can accurately count the viewers for each channel, just like the way that YouTube works.
We know exactly who's watching what, at what time of day, how long they're watching for, etc. And we're seeing advertisers coming over to View TV or online TV so that they can measure the traffic that's actually being put through to their site.
The
potentially all of this leads to the holy grail for advertisers, allowing them to talk to exactly the right sort of consumers who are interested in their products and serve them with product information, special offers, and nurture that customer relationship in a way that with old media you couldn't really do that.
It is a little pot of gold if your channel's successful. It isn't a little pot of gold if your channel isn't successful, because you can actually tell if you're a failure.
Internet television is becoming so widespread that household names are getting involved. Up there lives a broadcaster famous for his views on TV. Clive James used to be one of the most familiar faces on the box.
Welcome once again to the BBC's unique deregulated television show.
Now he invites friends to his library in his London flat and films conversations with them.
Terry Gilliam's graphic work for Monty Python would have been a whole career for a normal man. But it was just the beginning for a film director who would have changed the face of
the
cinema.
It was getting clear to me that the kind of TV I wanted to do was getting harder to get on the air. That I no longer live under that kind of pressure. I've retired. This is what I'm doing in my retirement. I retired from the mainstream TV, mainstream media in 2001.
Instead, Clive created a multimedia website.
See, I call the shots in this little thing I do. Now, I can remember what it was like not to call the shots. I got paid a lot more, incidentally. I got paid huge amounts of money, essentially, for cooperating with people.
Those days are gone, and we're all much older now.
I made my money in TV, and I kept it. I haven't got any toys except this. I've got no boats, I've got no cars, I've got a multimedia website.
Clive's website includes his DIY chat show, and this has attracted the most attention.
It's done right here, where we're doing it now. It's just that some of the guests are pretty amazing.
You've got that! No one else has got that!
Ironically, the satellite channel Arts World saw Clive's homemade show and liked it so much they bought the series.
The deal was that they can screen it, but I can screen it on my website forever. That's an alliance. The advantage for me is that it covers the cost.
So he's gone full circle. Clive's DIY internet project has ended up on the telly. The boundaries between internet and traditional broadcasting have blurred as content and stars flip from one place to another. It's the same for Kate. Her film started a media buzz and have led to the chance for her to branch out from YouTube into a fully fledged broadcasting career.
I think it could go anywhere from here. I've had a couple of offers for presenting on online television, but because of college, I haven't been able to take them up yet. Well, I've never really considered it before. This has all come around in the last 4 months. I haven't really had time to think about what I want to do with the rest of my life. But I'll see what the future holds.
The rapid and sudden success of YouTube, and the people on it, has shown how quickly the face of broadcasting is changing. For the established broadcasters, it represents a dilemma. Some are angry that their material is being ripped off on YouTube without permission. Fox and Viacom have publicly complained about the breach of copyright laws. But other broadcasters see an opportunity. Some, including the BBC, are negotiating a possible deal with YouTube, which will allow their clips to be shown legally.
Is the present policy the right policy?
Oh, Jeremy, do stop this nonsense.
Well, I think we'll have to stop the interview unless you've got anything else you particularly want to tell us this evening.
Well, certainly traditional media owners are very threatened by the internet, and you won't find a media owner out there now who doesn't have a business model that includes the internet and how they're going to take their brand online. So I think everyone recognises that their own business model is going to have to change, but they also recognise that the internet opens up their audience potential.
The final proof that YouTube is leaving behind its amateur roots came with this surprising announcement from Chad Hurley at Davos, the biggest corporate get-together in the world.
And in terms of paying users revenue against the content that they're uploading, we're definitely going to move in that direction.
Which means popular contributors like Peter and Kate could end up getting a share of the advertising revenue that YouTube generates from their films. That would bring them a step nearer to being professional broadcasters. But it's a risky strategy.
One of the important things, I think, to consider about the internet generation is that you have to treat commercialization on the internet very carefully, because a lot of the social networking sites thrive on the fact that there is no commercial influence, and you tread that line at your peril.
There are the risks of diminishing the actual excitement of YouTube by being part of a larger corporation. The risk to Google is that the very act of purchasing YouTube makes it uncool.
Even if YouTube does damage its credibility, DIY TV is here to stay, because now anyone can have an audience of millions for virtually nothing.
Hello, everybody at the BBC.
Hello, YouTubers. Grandpa's back in his chair.
Now, Peter has kindly lent me his study, or should I say studio, which must be one of the most famous locations on the internet these days. So, here goes. Let's put on the famous headset, Peter's headset. Now, with the advent of DIY TV, you can all make your own TV, and you can all be superstars. So, the question is, are you ready to become a celebrity?
Because there's one thing everyone agrees on in the world of DIY TV. You are the stars. And how does it make you feel to become, or to be now, one of the most popular YouTubers that there's been?
Terribly embarrassed.
I've never been someone who likes attention, so it's very strange to have all of this all of a sudden. I enjoy it, but I don't like to think of myself as a star or anything like that. Just somebody having some fun that other people appreciate.
You like the fame?
No, I don't like the fame. What I like is the warmth of the response from the people who have found me on YouTube. I'm not seeking popularity. What I have got and what I want to retain, and hopefully will retain, is a group of friends that I have made in the YouTube community. And what more does one want?
Oh, I don't know, Peter. Let's think. How about a singing thumb?
It's the money program on the BBC. The money program for you and me.
For more information, go to bbc.co.uk/moneyprogram. Next week, we've got the worst commute in Europe, and more of us are choosing to work here but live abroad. Meet Britain's dream commuters.
Next tonight, the piggy bank on Jimmy's farm.